Hi friends, welcome back to SPK English Academy. In today's class, we will discuss Victorian poetry, part 2. I am Sarada Basappa, working as English teacher in a government model school, Karnataka state. So, Victorian poetry is very important in the history of English literature. So, during the reign of Queen Victoria, she patronized many poets. So, this age is called as the golden age of English literature also. So, in the last class, we discussed Tennyson, Robert Browning and Mrs. Robert Browning. And today, we will discuss Matthew Arnold, Arthur Hopcliffe and Edward Pitcherall and Pre-Raphaelite poets. In the last video, we have discussed only the Pre-Raphaelite movement. Today, we will discuss who are the Pre-Raphaelite poets and their works. The question may be asked, which of the following is not a Pre-Raphaelite poet or which of the following is Pre-Raphaelite poet? You have to listen to carefully and note down who are the Pre-Raphaelite poets. See, first you look at Matthew Arnold. You have to study Matthew Arnold as a poet and also as a critic. You know, there is one of the most important critics in English literary theory. We discussed him as a critic. Today, we will discuss him as a poet. See, Matthew Arnold was an English poet and cultural critic. John Keble stood as good as godfather to Arnold. See, a great poet after Tennyson and Browning. So after Tennyson, Lord Alfred Tennyson and Robert Browning, Matthew Arnold was the great poet of Victorian age. See, Matthew Arnold was a classicist and he was also a pessimist. The elder son of Dr. Thomas Arnold, the headmaster of Rugby School. He was educated at Winchester Rugby and Balliol College, Oxford. He was also professor of poetry at Oxford. Now we look at Matthew Arnold's works. See, The Strayed Reveller and the October Poems, which was published in 1849. Empedocles on Etna, which was published in 1852, and Merov is the tragedy written by Matthew Arnold. It was published in 1858. See, Resignation, it embodies Arnold's initial conception of poet's calling. See, Quick Work and To a Friend are sonnets. You have to remember which are the sonnets of Matthew Arnold. Quick Work and To a Friend are sonnets written by Matthew Arnold. See, Requiescat is a song for the repose of the dead. See, this is one of the important poems or works of Matthew Arnold, that is Sohrab and Rustum, which was published in 1853, is a mini epic in English in blank verse. So it is a mini epic in blank verse. The story is taken from the Shahnama of the 11th century poet Firdowsi. The question may be asked, from which book is the Sohrab and Rustum taken from? Shahnama of the 11th century poet Firdowsi. Next work, The Forsaken Merman, the lament of a merman where human life has left him and her children at their home under the sea and gone back to land to pray in her church. And then Switzerland, it includes 7 poems addressed to or about Marguerite, a French girl who had captivated Arnold as a young man to Beme. See, The Stray Traveler and Other Poems, it was published in 1849. A young shepherd has strayed one early morning into the palace of Circe, the enchantress. See, The Dower Beach is very, very important poem written by Matthew Arnold. A question may be asked on this poem. You have to read this poem separately in detail. Thou a Lover, poem, it is more rhetorical than lyrical. It is so popular because it contains the most memorable expressions of Arnold's grief at his loss of faith. See, lyrics, self-defense, morality, and the burial of life or other works. The Scholar Gypsy is very important work written by Matthew Arnold. The Scholar Gypsy was published in 1853. So it is a pastoral poem, is based upon an old legend related by Joseph Glanville, a 17th century clergyman in his vanity of dogmatizing of a young student of Oxford who forced by poverty left the university and joined a band of wandering gypsies. So this is the story of that Scholar Gypsy. Other works of Matthew Arnold. See, that is Tiresias. You know that Tiresias is one of the most important elegies in English literature. So it was published in 1865. This elegy is in the memory of Arnold's close friend Arthur Holland Clough. It was written some 4 years after the death of Arthur Holland Clough in 1861. See, Memorial Verses is another work by Matthew Arnold. It was published in 1850. In this, Arnold pays a tribute to Byron, Goethe, and Wordsworth. The question may ask, who did Matthew Arnold tribute in his Memorial Verses? See, remember, Lord Byron, Goethe, and William Wordsworth. So these poets, three poets. See, Rugby Chapel, it was another work written by Matthew Arnold, which was published in 1867. In this poem, Arnold pays a noble and well-deserved tribute to the memory of his father who had died 15 years before. See, Stanzas from Grand Chartreuse, published in 1855. In this poem, Arnold visited La Grande Chartreuse, the Carthusian monastery near Grenoble. See, Stanzas in Memory of the author Obermann, which was published in 1849. The author of Obermann is sentimental French novel without sentimentality. See, Stanzas in Memories of Arthur Obermann is a novel. Or the author of Obermann is a sentimental French novel. But in this novel, there is no sentimentality. See, other important works, Meroff, a tragedy written by Matthew Arnold, Empedocles and Other Poems, published in 1852, Memorial Verses to Wordsworth, gender work. And then now we look at, so that is Arthur Hawk Clough, the close friend of Matthew Arnold. See, he was an English poet, an educationalist, and the devoted assistant to Florence Nightingale. See, Florence Nightingale, one of the world popularized nurses. Matthew Arnold was his close friend, so he wrote an elegy, Tiresias, on his death. He died at Florence at the early age of 42. Now look at works of Arthur Hawk Clough. See, first work, the Bothai, a long vacation pastoral, his principal poem describes a trip of Oxford students to islands. Amos D. Ovas Dipsichu. This is series of amusing letters in hexameter telling the story of an English law office in Italy during the Italian Revolution. Now we have to look at Edward Fitzgerald, another great poet of Victorian poetry. See, Irish stock, educated at Trinity College, Cambridge, and he was a great friend of Tennyson and Thackeray. See, Tennyson dedicated his Tiresias to him, and Thackeray, while going to America in 1852, asked him in a most affectionate letter to be his literary executor in case something should happen to him. See, his translations of Rubaiyat-o Khayyum, Omar Khayyum, his famous poem of Edward Fitzgerald, made him immortal in the history of English literature. Fitzgerald translated 8 dramas from the Spanish of Calderon and 3 from Greek, Agamemnon, Oedipus the King, Oedipus at Colonus. So these are 3 great Greek dramas. These were translated from Greek into English by Edward Fitzgerald. This is the great important achievement of Fitzgerald. The question may ask, who translated the Greek tragedies Agamemnon, Oedipus the King, Oedipus at Colonus into English? Edward Fitzgerald. Next important poets of Victorian age are Pre-Raphaelites. So in the last video, we discussed the Pre-Raphaelite movement, what are its principles, and who are the dominant figures of this Pre-Raphaelite movement or brotherhood. Now we have to look at how this Pre-Raphaelite movement takes place, or who are the great poets of Pre-Raphaelite movement. So, real renewal of romantic tradition, supposing it to have been broken by Browning and Arnold, was the work of a group of poets called as the Pre-Raphaelites. See, real renewal of romantic tradition. So, Pre-Raphaelite is the real renewal of romantic tradition, and are supposing it to have been broken by Browning and Arnold, was the work of a group of poets called as the Pre-Raphaelites poets. About the middle of the century, in 1848, to be precise, a few painters combined to oppose the existing pompous conventions of academics of art, which ignored such modern painters as Blake, Turner, and Constable. See, they called themselves to be Pre-Raphaelites to emphasize their admiration for the Italian painters before Raphael, whose work they thought was characterized by simplicity, sincerity, and religious feelings. See, the term, they meant a return to medievalism, one of the chief characteristics of Romanticism. See, though a painter's movement, its connection with literature was due to the fact that its leader, D.G. Rossetti, he was the painter and poet. He was the leader of this Pre-Raphaelite movement. See, the purely painter members who founded the Pre-Raphaelites or the Brotherhood movement, such as Holman Hunt, J. Millais, and others, do not concern us. See, the poets who, besides Rossetti, came to be associated with the group were William Morris, Algernon, Charles Swinburne. So these are very important poets of Pre-Raphaelite movement. The Pre-Raphaelites found an ardent support in Ruskin, who too was a great admirer of the Middle Ages. See, the creed as stated in their magazine, The Journ, in the last video I discussed, the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. In Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, all the poets started a magazine called, that is, The Journ, was an entire adherence to the simplicity of art. It is an important chiefly because it contained the earliest version of the Blessed Damsel. See, the Blessed Damsel is one of the most important poems by D.G. Rossetti in that Pre-Raphaelite moment. It contains all the characteristics and principles of Pre-Raphaelite moment. See, now we look at the most important representer or representative poet of Pre-Raphaelite principles. So that is D.G. Rossetti. D.G. Rossetti was the son of an Italian patriot who came to England as a refugee in 1824. He was educated at King's College, London, but soon devoted himself to painting. His Blessed Damsel and other poems first appeared in The Journ in 1850, founded and started by himself. See, in 1871, he was attacked by Robert Buchanan under the pseudonym Thomas Maitland in an article entitled The Fleshly School of Poetry. To this Rossetti replied in the Stately School of Criticism. See, his second volume of poetry was called The Ballads and Sonnets, was published in 1881, and other work, Hand and Soul, it is his prose story. Mystic is identification of physical love and spiritual love. Love Nostrum, The Stream's Secret, The Sonnets of the House of Life, all in the nature of picture puzzles, and each takes hours to explore. Ballads, Troy Town, Eden Browse, Sister Helen, Rosemary, The White Sheep, The King's Treasury. So all these are the ballads written by D.G. Rossetti. See, the most important work written by D.G. Rossetti, that is The Blessed Damsel. So this poem is the representative poem of Pre-Raphaelite characteristics and its principles and its theme. See, The Blessed Damsel is a maiden who after death has become one of the gods' choristers. Her lover is still living and pining for her. She leans from the gold bar of the rampart of God's palace in heaven, which spans like a bridge the void of space below. Look down from the vast height, she surveys the world and sees souls mounting up to God like thin flames. She speaks, bending over him, their united prayers. She believes will surely be granted when in due course he comes up heaven. She will unashamedly declare their love to Virgin Mary, who will herself lead to them to Christ. The damsel will beg him unite them forever so that they might live together in heaven as for a while they had lived on earth. Now, another important poet of this Pre-Raphaelite moment is Christiana Rossetti. See, the painter poet's sister was almost as a great poet as her brother. See, Christiana Rossetti was the sister of D.G. Rossetti, a devoted adherent of the Church of England. See, she was intensely religious and rejected two offers of marriages on religious grounds. See, she was a skilled sonnet writer, so she wrote a sonnet sequence, that is Monna in Nominata, is the sonnet sequence written by Christiana Rossetti. See, her sonnets are autobiographical and show a deep sense of loss resulting from her two attachments. Goblin Market is a fantastic tale with allegorical meaning. So look at Christiana's works, Goblin Market and other poems. See, The Prince's Progress and other poems, The Peasant and other poems, The New Poems. So these are important volumes published by Christiana Rossetti. Now another poet is William Morris. He is also one of the main important poets of pre-Raphaelite movement. So he was a son of wealthy merchant, was educated at Oxford, where he founded and conducted for a year the Oxford and Cambridge magazine. See, he came under the spell of Newman and Tractarian movement. See, from 1883 onwards, his chief activities were designing for his firm and working on behalf of socialist movement. See, works of William Morris, The Defense of Guernavere and other poems, The Life and Death of Jason, The Earthly Paradise, Love is Enough, Sigurd the Volsung, Poems by the Way. See, Algernon Charles Swinburne, another important poet of this pre-Raphaelite movement. So, Swinburne was the son of Admiral Swinburne, was educated at Eton and Oxford. He failed in scriptures. He left the university without a degree. See, in 1860, he published a volume containing two romantic plays, that is Queen Mother and Rosamond, dedicated to Rossetti. See, in 1865, he published Atlanta Calydon, which placed him in the front rank of Victorian poets. So other poems, poems and ballads. Ethusus, his trilogy called Chesterlord, Bothwell, Sunrise. So these are the three trilogies of Swinburne. And Tristram of Lyonesse, another one work of Swinburne. So these are the works and poets of that Victorian age. You do study all these poets carefully. Every year there is a question on pre-Raphaelite movement and Tennyson and other poets. So study and prepare well for the exams. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, subscribe to my channel for the next coming videos. Thank you for watching my video. Keep on watching and support me and encourage me to do the remaining